Sarah, how are you?
Doing great. How about you, Ryan?
Well, you and I are both, I'm literally staring at the snow. So anybody that's not Minnesota does not care, but you and I were just complaining because it was 60 degrees on Easter Saturday and now it is 20 and snowing and while we're quarantined. So this is going to be fun human interaction that I'm looking forward to.
Yeah, exactly.
I think we're over it. And I'm excited to get into this conversation because you and I were just chatting. You've got a lot of experience in the family business world from one of the local universities in Minnesota, but then also with your EOS practice that you built out. And then you actually even launched a new platform that I'm excited to hear your reasoning and your why behind. So I think we'll have plenty of things to chat about from the family business perspective. And I think there's gonna be a lot more items that I'm going to add to I wish I would have list.
Okay. Well, so great.
Let's go and give the listeners a little bit of your background, Sarah. Like, how did you get into the interest behind the family business industry?
Yeah, sure. Well, it started, I grew up in central Wisconsin in a small town where every adult who had a job was either working at the school or the hospital or running their own family business or working for one in many, many ways. That was very, very true. And my dad and uncle ran a business together. My mom and aunt helped out there. And then, of course, the kids did. I assigned myself to wash the bathrooms at that business. I had good friends who owned an orchard, and we would help pick strawberries and whatnot. And I picked strawberries next to sets of cousins whose parents were fighting over who lived in which house. So this is part of my growing up and just what I thought the world of business was. Grew up, went to college, started thinking about what I wanted to do in the world. And after a long journey, realized that in my opinion, the best way to have a major positive impact on the world is to work with the owners of family businesses. In my experience, they're the best employers. They tend to be very attentive to their communities. When they're great employers, their employees are happy. When their employees are happy, those people's kids are happy. When those kids are happy, schools are happy. So this is where my passion lined up.
How did you find that out?
And I mean, it's a lot of missteps, I would say, but the part that sounds really, oh my gosh, if you can edit this out, that'd be great. But anyway, the way I found it out is this. Here's what I knew. I wanted to make a positive difference in the world. I thought maybe teaching might be the way to do that or being a doctor or something. But I ended up finding executive coaching. And a lot of the people I coached, of course, were business owners or leaders. And I just kept seeing that the family business owners were so invested. Mm-hmm. Then I went and worked at Target for a while, which came out of a family business. And I saw the fingerprints of a family business's thinking, even in this publicly traded business.
Oh, no kidding. That's an interesting perspective. I didn't know that.
Yeah, I really felt working at Target like their horizon was well beyond the quarterly earnings call. And for me anyway, I connected that back to them being an mm-hmm. entrepreneurial effort of a well-known family business in Minnesota that, well, still has ties to the community and does mm-hmm. a lot for the community. And I liked my work at Target a lot, but missed the experience I had as a coach and ended up leaving there and going to St. Thomas, where I ran the Family Business Center for 6 years and got to turn that program around. And at the first event I had there, there were, I think, 18 people there. And I've heard the last time they could have in-person events, there were close to 250 people there. And hopefully they'll get to be in person again not too long from now.
So, which is super cool. And it's a resource that where I was saying, I wish I would. I don't even know how predominant that was when I was in our family business now that it's been a while. Why don't you get, there's probably so many things that you learned while you're there. And maybe before we dive into it, it's up to you, Sarah, whether you want to kind of explain your EOS and the Sage of what you're doing now, and then we can go back into it. But I'm curious in how your journey went as you were at St. Thomas. But why don't you finish the other couple of things you're doing?
Yeah. I'll talk about that a little bit. So I was running the Family Business Center, and all these family businesses kept telling me about this book called Traction by Gino Wickman. My view of my job at the Family Business Center was to protect the family businesses from the flavor of the month. So probably the first 10 people who mentioned it to me, I said, oh, yeah, whatever. Then I finally picked up the book and said, oh, my goodness, this is exactly what family businesses need. It's clear. It's direct. It's practical. It helps them run a great business. It helps them be clear about who should be doing what the expectations are. So through that, I ended up becoming an EOS implementer. I ultimately left St. Thomas and the Family Business Center. And just next month, I will celebrate 5 years of being an EOS implementer and focusing on working with family businesses, primarily in Minnesota. Well, it's such awesome. Powerful work.
I think what's interesting, and maybe we can kind of figure out how this comment takes you with the material, is like, I find, yeah. Sarah, like the biggest challenge that my dad and I had, or people that come through our boot camps or our clients, is that this concept of like ownership versus management, yeah. roles, and separating, yes. like, we're like, okay, estate planning, buyouts, transitions of the financial matters happen on the ownership versus like the W-2 incomes of people. And I find so many people try to solve all their problems through payroll instead of through ownership. And, and so like, I know that's a blanket comment because it probably ties into all your experience at the center as well as EOS. So like, what are some of the biggest challenges? Like, how does that resonate with you? Or, I mean, I just think that that's such a huge...
It absolutely does. I love how you put that, solving problems through payroll. That is, if you don't mind, I'm going to borrow that and I will give you credit. That's so good. I'm going to talk about the Sage Pages here a little bit because it's connected that, and then I want to actually talk about a tool that I think is so valuable. So I've just recently started another business called the Sage Pages, and it's an online resource for family businesses to find the best advisors who really understand them and will hold them to a high expectation. And advisors also who will bring in other advisors when they're needed. So unfortunately, there's a lot of advisors out there who think, oh, well, I can help with the conflict and I can help with the finance and I can help with the legal and I can help with everything. And
just bill me. Just let me bill you and I'll be fine. Yep,
yeah. Right. And you know, you can pay me $450 an hour to help you stop fighting with your son. Sure, I'll figure that out. That worries me so much. So I have a big, big, big passion around educating family businesses to serve themselves well and to make sure they are served well. And the Sage Pages grew out of that. I'm also putting together the best resources for family businesses so they can get the education they need and in a way that is practical and includes tools they can use right away. And I wanted to go to that and then back up to this tool. So probably my first day of work, or before I even started at the Family Business Center, I found the three-circle model of family business. And any of your listeners can Google this, unless they're just like me and they're driving. So Google it later. But the three-circle model of family business is a super simple-looking tool. It's a three-circle Venn diagram. The bottom two circles are your family and your business. And then the top circle is ownership. Hopefully the way I described that made it quite clear to you. But that solving problems through payroll, I think a lot of family businesses only think of those three circles as the business circle.
Yeah.
And they want to solve all the family issues and all the ownership issues in that one circle, or they've just collapsed those three circles, the family and the business and ownership, into one circle, and they're trying to manage everything through that. Every family business I've ever put that model in front of has said, oh, or something like that, right? Like, oh, there's a separate set of priorities and decision-making and tools you use in the family circle. And those are separate priorities and tools from what you use in the business. And then, of course, the ownership circle is a completely set of different set of priorities mm-hmm. and tools that you need to employ to make great decisions. And I like to say this, the ownership circle, that circle's job is to maximize opportunity for the family and the business. Right? The ownership circle should be thinking about the family and the business, maximizing opportunity, whatever that looks like. Often it's a financial opportunity, but not always. It's also the ownership circle's job to minimize risk for the family and the business. Mm-hmm. And that's a big job, to maximize opportunity, minimize risk in both sides. And at least when you say solving problems through payroll, I think of what I often call the Aunt Matilda issue. Where I think you know where I'm going, yeah. right? A family business will employ Aunt Matilda because Aunt Matilda's having a hard time in life and they can just give her a paycheck, but then she comes to work, she doesn't do anything, and all the other employees get mad. They want to quit and the business goes downhill. But hey, we took care of Aunt Matilda. It's solid gold intentions, but taking care of Aunt Matilda financially is really a family priority.
it shouldn't be a business or an ownership priority.
You nailed so many things there. And I think I want to kind of explore too, Sarah, about like, how does this happen and why does this happen and how do people get out of it too? Because as we built out our bootcamp education material and all of our material, we actually had to address this because we kept realizing people just don't know how to decouple the two. And what I find interesting is my partner's a CFO, right? So like it's super like columns and rows and zeros and ones and like, well, there's the ownership and then this is how much it's worth. And like, and I'm like, but that's not how everybody thinks. And so, so we actually had to go through and separate this. And we actually, in our diagram, we have the freeloaders, which technically those are add backs and you can normalize your EBITDA. So like, even like how that Venn diagram, if you show it from a financial perspective, it gets all muddied too, because if they're not necessary, it actually increases the value of the company. So like,
yes,
it's super interesting of like, when you start to really figure out, I'm curious on like your years of doing this, what are the major issues that come up, or not, maybe not the major issues, but what are the major factors that lead into the solving through payroll? Like what are your observations of is it the lack of knowledge in certain things? Why does that actually happen?
I'm going to say, I mean, the list of reasons could go on and on, but I'm going to narrow it down to two things. One is leadership in each of the three circles. And the second is a lack of vision for the three circles. And this is what I mean. For the family really needs a leader. The business needs a leader and the ownership circle needs a leader. And I'm going to make up a statistics here, right? Because 9 out of 10 statistics are false. or I should say 9 out of 10 statistics are made up, and that's what this is. So, but I'm just going to make it a number up. 9 out of 10 first generation family business owners, they are the leader of the family and the business and ownership. They just are. They're one person. They founded it. If the business was founded in 1955, dad was probably the leader of the household, or so he thought, right? I'm using generic statements here, right? But they were the leader. And then there's not a sense of seeing that really it's valuable, especially as a second generation comes in, to start to separate that thinking. So it's just, there's lack of seeing the need for separate leaders. And by leaders, I'm just going to slow this down a little bit. By leaders, this is what I mean. The leader of the business is there to run a great business that meets the needs and expectations of the owners. Mm-hmm. And often people think that the leader of the business is there to meet the needs and expectations of the family. Mm-hmm. But it's actually the owner's needs they should be thinking about. And that's a fine difference, but it's really important.
Well, and let's actually, for vernacular, you know, kind of interchange a couple of words too. It's the ownership needs, but it's truly the value of the company, right? Like, because the more, like what we preach is like, the more valuable of a business you have, the more choices you have. And until, like one of our big, like, phrases is you have to shift your mindset away from annual income, so maximizing your K-1 or your distributions, to long-term value creation. And once that shift happens, it's easier to like talk about ownership of who actually owns this thing. But what happens is so interesting is like you talk about the first gen where like there's so much ego wrapped up into like, I built this and I have this and I created this and I employed these people and like I get to willy-nilly do whatever I want with my distributions, because it's all being focused on solving for annual income instead of the other way around.
Absolutely. And that's where I say, I think where this issue comes from is not clear leadership and not clear vision. Because if your business leader, which might also be the owner, but you know, but let's separate it, right? It's better, it's more clear when it's separated. If your business leader is focused on, you know, the needs and desires of ownership, ownership's needs and desires typically are much bigger than annual income. Mm-hmm. It's a legacy they might be trying to accomplish here. It probably is around money, but it's probably around long-term value. And what does that mean? And that's a legacy in my book. So the other thing is people lose sight of this, that is, and for just for fun's sake, let's say the leader of a business is the CEO. The leader of a family also has a role, and that is to keep the family from always and only talking about the business. It's to keep the family focused on things like, do we have traditions? Are we maintaining the glue of our family? Because times go times are tough sometimes, like right mm-hmm. now. And family businesses can really succeed during these times because a lot of them have this family stability. And that leader of the family, that's often their role. And if the leader of the business is the CEO, the leader of the family also is. They're the chief emotional officer.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big role.
I'm curious. Yeah. And I, cause I'm in total agreement with you in like the concept of the three circles and how you're breaking these apart. So say you're like, when you have someone that comes to you and doesn't get these things and it's all literally in one big blender, how do you start piecing it apart? Cause like, you know, I went through it and I watch other people that go through it and it's usually miserable conflict or an out of the blue offer or some big like catalyst from the outside that puts undue pressure on the family and the business that forces conflict to have them figure this out versus going, okay, like we can start building this puzzle before that kind of stuff happens. How do mm-hmm. you start, how do you lead that breadcrumb trail to people really understanding it?
It's almost always just what you said. There's some pain point that happens. Out of the blue offer, family member gets sick, somebody threatens to quit, somebody gets tired of running the day-to-day, right? You know, there's always a pain point. And that, I mean, isn't that true for anything, right? So we need to paint our house because the garage door needs to be painted, right? The garage door is the thing that's making us do it, right? So I often, what I've noticed is families come in with one of the three circles as a pain point. It's either our conflict has exploded and our family's not talking to each other. Something's wrong in the business. It's not profitable anymore, or it's just too darn hard to work, or we can't figure out what leadership succession should be. Or on the ownership side, we're lost. We're just not even sure what we want, or we're trying to figure out how to transition from one generation to the next. And probably obvious, when a person comes with a business, when the issue or the pain point is on the business side, that's when I bring in EOS or the Entrepreneurial Operating System, because it's just such an elegant job of getting clear about who's running it, who should be there, who should be on payroll, who shouldn't be, and where are we headed, right? Clear who the vision is, clear what the vision is, and clear who the leaders are. If they come in on the family side, I mean, this is kind of connected to my passion around the Sage Pages. There's a person I send everybody to if they have so much conflict they can't talk to each other. There's a person I send people to just get to the point where they can talk again. And then they can come back to me and we either do the EOS work, or I have some work that I do with people around ownership as well, about getting the ownership group clear about what is that legacy? What are they trying to create? What's the big picture of what's happening here?
So, which is awesome, because I agree with you that they probably have some sort, I mean, there is a pain point that's probably surfaced, but like, how many times do you see it? Whether you're back at St. Thomas Family Business Center or in any of these conversations where they bring up what they think the problem is and it's not even close to the problem.
Gosh, let me think about that. You know, it's probably quite often.
You can make up another stat if you want.
Yeah. I'll say 12 times out of nine.
There you go.
So that's probably often true. But you know what I've learned over time is, even if I think I see, like, oh, you said A is the problem, but B is really the problem, let's address A, because before, if we use a good, solid process, B is going to come to the top. If that makes sense.
It does. Yeah. And I think you hit a really important topic there is the process, right? Because just telling someone that they're wrong is not the right issue.
And typically doesn't work very well.
No, and like in being able to, like, what I like about what you're talking about at the EOS, it's gets it once, it's got the capacity, what's the org chart, right? Like, are they really truly necessary? And what I find interesting is, like, all this stuff is tied together, but then there's like this like perfect yin yang of like the financials and then the people problems, because like there's so much emotion, but that comes from a lack of clarity on the financials and vice versa, where like, unless you actually have that stuff separated and like people are just trying to solve for how do I make my money and how works my wealth, but they don't know how to separate all that stuff. So like, how do you tie it all together? Because I think it's such a challenge where someone might have a problem with someone, but it's because they don't know how that impacts the rest of the variables.
Oh my gosh. It's so often. Well, here's an example I'll see to be generic about how this tends to go. Dad will say, we need to pay our daughter more money because she's running the business. And, you know, our son is sweeping the floor in the warehouse. you know, she should make more money. And mom says, oh, no, you don't. Both of my kids are equally wonderful and they get paid the same. Right? And mom has a good point. Both of her children are equally wonderful. But here's what I often talk about is this idea that fair is not always equal. Mm-hmm. And fair and equal have different definitions depending on the circle you're in. So I'll talk about the family circle. And in my opinion, maybe not everybody's, everybody should get the same amount of money or value of a gift for a holiday or their birthday. That should be equal. But fair is not equal, and it is not equal or healthy inside of the business. You should get paid for the work you do and what the market says you get paid. And then ownership is the same thing. I mean, ownership needs to be drawn up not according to fair is equal the way we think of it in the family, but it's what's the most appropriate thing for the legacy you're trying to build for your family. And for some families, it is. If you've got two kids, it's 50-50, but holy cow, that can cause a lot of problems, especially if one family member is much more capable as an owner than another family member, which is typical.
Well, and I agree with you. And I think another layer on top of that is like, you might have someone that addresses the right here, right now, which is like, let's say you and I were brothers and sisters and we did have 50-50 of the estate. But if you were running the business and driving value, that doesn't mean that I will always have 50% of the future growth. You know what I mean? Like there's ways to make sure that's tied to whatever's fair inside of that circle versus
exactly.
Just, I mean, I watched too many times, right? You've probably seen it where someone, the sibling like that, like you drove value for 10 years and I still own, I'm just a total free rider.
Right. And now I, the one who runs the business, I'm really mad at you and don't want to see you at Thanksgiving. And you who doesn't run the business can't figure out why you used to get a certain amount of money every quarter and now you get less. Well, look around, the economy went crazy or right, whatever, right? Yep. That sort of, is it freeloader? Is that what you, the language you use? Yeah. That's so destructive to family relationships. And it kills off that opportunity that strong families have right now in a hard time to bring the family in to support a business.
Maybe you can kind of recite, because I think they're fairly universal, but the stats of business, family businesses that go to generation, I'd say that's pretty universal at this point. But like maybe give some insights that you have from working with that many family businesses over the years, like what are they, how are they approaching this the right way? Like what are some signs of success and challenges as they're building this model out?
Yeah. So you're referencing those statistics about how I think if I'm remembering correctly, only maybe 3% make it to the third generation or something like that. I've tried to unmemorize those statistics because I read somewhere that they're not necessarily accurate, but it's very dramatic, right? So let's just say if 100 businesses start today, three will be around by the third generation. That's super dramatic. So, but the ones who are doing it well, in my opinion, are doing things like joining a family business center, or participating in boot camps, or looking to looking to someone like you, or to talk about my passion and the Sage Pages, right? They're looking outside of themselves for some help and some education. And the reason I say that is not to just do three accidental advertisements there. I really do care about these things, right?
I'll have it. It's all right.
Okay. I promise you didn't pay me to say that, but I really believe this, right? Because here's what happens. Many, many, many family businesses think they're the only ones going through this. And when a family business joins something like a family business center, they come to see that everybody else is going through the same thing. Mm-hmm. So that's one of the biggest pieces, in my opinion, of success is they start to network and get really honest about what's going on and they learn from other people. So that's one of the biggest ones. One of the second biggest pieces is they get really clear about what they want out of this thing. And it has to be beyond grandma started the business. I loved my grandma. I want to make sure her business doesn't die under my watch. Although that's a very
noble.
Very noble. On the hard days, like many business owners are going through today, it's hard to wake up from grandma's legacy. You got to connect it to your legacy. What are you trying to create? And this is what I like to say to owners. Your legacy is defined by two things. One is, why are you running this place? Why do you keep running this family business that's complicated, where you have family members and the business and ownership all in one? Why? And it's got to be beyond grandma started it. It's like, I really, an answer for many people is I love being an employer. I love creating great jobs. Okay, that's why.
Right.
Or I deeply care about Minnesota and our economic future. Okay, that's a why.
It's tangible, right? Yep.
It's really tangible. It's about your own values and your own view. And it probably is part of the reason grandma started it too. So it's got a line of connection. The second piece of your legacy is, what are you trying to create today that you won't enjoy yourself, right? It's going to still be here in 100 years, long after you're gone. To me, that's a legacy. When family businesses can create that and get clear about that, and I'll give you an example of around 100 years from now. For some people, it is great education, great parks. It could be a strong economy kind of thing, right? A strong Minnesota, you know, whatever that is. It could be wealth for the family. That might be the why we're doing it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, great benefit and great jobs to the in the community. It could be things like that, right? So when you have that clear sense of legacy, and then when family businesses are honest and have all the hard conversations they need to have great leaders, that's when they're set up. They're still going to have conflict, right? You can't have a business and you can't have a family without conflict. It's just guaranteed. So,
yeah. If you don't like it, get out right now. Go.
Right. If you can't handle that, I don't know how you handle life, right? So, I mean, they're guaranteed. But what you don't want to have is the conflict that ruins the business, ruins people, the conflict that causes, you know, divorces or abuse or addiction, right? That's what we're trying to not have. We know we're going to have conflict, but when you have that kind of clarity, then all those financial decisions become a lot more clear.
Yeah, I would agree.
Right? With you. It's like we will buy this building because it aligns with our values or our legacy. Or no, we don't need to own the building because it doesn't really align with where we're trying to go.
It's so good, the stuff that you're saying here, because I do believe that. I mean, the hard conversations, you have to have those, because I actually think that it's when people don't have them.
Yeah,
it just festers, and that's what causes all that other shit. It's just like
it is.
Yeah, it's the passive aggressive BS, and then you just have to. It's really uncomfortable, and I think leaning into that stomach ache, it's the only way to.
That's a great way to put it. That is a really great way to put it, and you know that's part of the reason I like EOS, for example. You touched on this earlier too. It creates a process. That because you're committed to the process, the conflict isn't personal, if that makes sense, right? You're committed to running a great business. And in order to run a great business, you have to have this hard conversation. And so you do. And yes, it was conflict, but you all agreed to do it.
Well, I think it ties into what you're talking about with the vision too, because because we weren't running EOS, because this is, you know, in early 2010 to 14, where it was kind of just starting at that point.
Yep,
but when I was turning around and, you know, going through people, and I mean, it was terrible. It went from toxic to an amazing culture. But what we did is I'd point to the data and said, well, we all said that these were our unified goals. So if they didn't get accomplished, it was someone's fault. But it wasn't me, you know, bashing your, you know, sense of purpose or identity.
Yes.
It was we determined that this is what was going to happen with inventory. This is what's going to happen with sales. And it didn't happen. So that's what a process flushes out. And then it identifies the person instead of someone blaming the person.
Absolutely. And it's not personal. I mean, it might not feel good, but it's not personal. It's not brother beating up on brother. It's not dad mad at daughter. It's we agreed to this. What the heck happened?
So I got a question for you of what you've seen with other multi-generation families on, one thing that's interesting, because you have kind of two, probably a bunch of different flavors of second gen, but you have some that are just okay, I'm going to come in there and just work hard. And then you have... And work hard to take this over, and it's going to be handed over methodically. And then I was part of this. I'm a raging visionary. So I came in with lots of ideas, and I not only were we in turnaround, so I wanted you have this whole challenge of, I saw the future of managed IT services and software and all these different things to transform the copier business. But there's multiple challenges that I see with partners and family businesses where you have different visions that collide as well. So then the different visions then come into who's doing what, how are we deploying human capital, how are we deploying investments, and then investing in the business and identifying our rocks, all that kind of stems down from the vision. And then also risk tolerance there, right? My dad was I want to start, clipping coupons and making more cash. And I'm like, let's hire more engineers. And he's like, no. And so like, it's like that problem of whose vision is it? And how do we transfer the vision? How do we keep evolving as a business? But also, does that make sense? I think there's just,
it does.
How do you unwind that?
Oh, there's so many pieces to what you just said, because part of it is a generational response and an age response, right? I don't know. I mean, is your dad, I'm guessing, a baby boomer?
Yeah.
No. Guessing, right? Here you are now.
Copiers were technology when he started the business.
So of course he's going to have one approach, and he's thinking retirement and future, and I'm going to want my money sometime in the next 5 years. You're thinking in the next,
we sold the business because he wanted 30. His money.
right? Yeah. So there's just that going on, whether you're family or not. So I see that all the time, of course. And, you know, I sound repetitive here, but that is, again, having those tough conversations as owners. And now I'm talking ownership circle. Can you agree on what you want out of this thing? Can you actually agree on what you want? And then if you can agree on that, in theory, those financial decisions become a lot more clear, right? If it's just, we got to sell this thing, we got to turn around and turn it and burn it as fast as we can. Well, then that's one set of choices, hopefully. But it sounds like maybe you had a shared vision and you still had a different way that you wanted to go about it. But part of that then is owners saying, okay, we will give the reins to this person or this group of people to run the business and accomplish what we're asking for. And that's what I often see in second generation. First generation and often second generation assumes, well, if I'm going to own it or if I do own it, I have to run it. And that's just not true. Smart owners hire the right people to run the business. And that's not always a family member.
Well, and I think what's interesting, Sarah, is like as we built out our curriculum and our material behind the five principles, like the logic that comes from it is like, okay, what do you want? And then we know that those are, so that's the first principle. And then the second one is like, okay, well, obviously you care about the financials. Like how much is this worth? How much are you collecting from an income? And like, are you going to be fine? So we have to layer, kind of stack them on top of each other. And then the third principle is the exit options. And whether you want to sell or not, it's like you can transfer your role differently than transfer your ownership. And I don't think people know that. And then it's like, because if you stack on your, what do you want? Then with your financial targets, then you say, okay, now here's how my options for liquidation of my ownership and my role, you can kind of build that puzzle however you want. And then if you have a missing target, then you can build value to go get it. And I just don't think people get it. And they just argue about shit instead.
Oh my gosh. I have that really key. How did you just say that? Knowing.
So these are the five principles. And and it's so funny because you're an EOS implementer, and like, I didn't want to recreate what Gino did at all, because I think he's a genius. I was like, taking this complicated problem of like all this crap that's out there. And so the five principles literally came into how do we unpack it? So the first principle is, what do you want? Like literally legacy, family, business, all the community. Now we have, now obviously they're financial issues. So we tack on, there's three of them. What is your target income that you want? What's your target valuation net proceeds? So like, what's the company worth today and what do you want it to be worth? And then how does your outside net worth impact those decisions? Because it's a lens. You can't ignore the fact that some family businesses, they are owners, they might have tens of millions of dollars and they don't need to liquidate the business, where some, the parents might need the money, which might limit the choices. So then you go in and say, okay, now I know what I want, what my financial targets are. What are my options? And down the road from exiting the ownership and transitioning your role. So you kind of take that split of the management, then most people are not satisfied. So then they can grow value to get what they want.
Mm-hmm.
But that's where like this, I'm curious on your input, because I spent 6 years, I went into this whole exit planning, value building industries, and owners have a visceral reaction to exit because I think they don't know this stuff, Sarah. And like, because like you could sell to an ESOP, make a ton of money and run your company and invest in your company and have a $250,000 salary for the next 20 years. And people just don't know this stuff.
Yes. I'll finish what you were saying.
I just find it crazy. So that's why we literally changed the name of everything to intentional growth, because it ties into people's ego instead of, because actually people just think they're going to sell. And I'm like, it's so not the truth, but you have to understand how this works to build your plan.
Absolutely. This is, you're putting your finger right on a conversation that I participate in regularly. And it's people coming in with a certain set of assumptions. And it might be, I have to run it. I have to work 80 hours a week. I have to go through all of the accounts receivable, right? Just blindly yeah, assuming yeah. they have to do all of those things or some version of that. And I think to the great detriment of a lot of people, their entire identity gets wrapped up in the business and they literally can't imagine what it would look like to work, let's call it 8 to 12 hours a week and maybe start another business or hang out with their grandkids or, you know, become a teacher or whatever they want to do, yeah. right? It's like, it's not even possible. And I think that thing and why I think this podcast and what you're doing is so valuable is to open people's minds up to the bajillion options they probably have that they're just not, they don't have a concept of right now because they just think I have to do it just like grandpa did it. And he worked 7 days a week for 12 hours a day.
And what you just said is like, so like if your identity is all trapped into this, what I think people think is like, I have to pass it on to my kids in some long drawn out drama filled, non-profitable way, or I just sell the thing. And yeah. it's so unfortunate because like, if you literally just run the numbers, which we do in our bootcamp through the case studies, we're like, you $10 million business in revenue, $1 million in EBITDA, times it by five is $5 million. Take away 33% for taxes. And then you pay down your debt and you walk away with $1.2 million and you are used to $300,000 lifestyle. The math don't work.
Yeah.
And so what happens is, people find out after the fact because the only way to sell their identity and move on was to completely sever it, like with like an umbilical cord. When there's like hard work that I think the work that you do helps people unpack this because they can't just do it immediately.
No. I hear so many next generation leaders saying they won't let the business go. They won't let me run it, and it's true. But it's also like, of course they won't. What would they do with their afternoon if they let you run it? What would they do? They don't know, right? And that's not easy work to wrap your head around. What does my day look like when I don't go in to a building that has my last name on it? That's not easy to figure out.
Or I'll even put one back to you and say, what do I do when I don't have a building to go back into that still has my name on it and I don't have the roles?
Yep. Yeah. Not easy. Not also, I would not say it's okay to stifle the next generation's ability to have their chance to run it. I don't think that's okay either.
How do you advise, or what have you seen that's worked? Maybe is a better question.
Yeah.
On how people, if you're an owner that like, and by the way, this is, I don't devalue this or like, cause it's a real situation and perception is reality. So like this is
absolutely
real life problems. And I've interviewed too many people that have agreed on that. And so like, what successful things have you seen that people have gone through while they own their company to figure this out for themselves?
Yeah, I've seen a lot of things that were successful, and I've seen a lot of things that were fits and starts. So the successful things, again, is hearing other stories of when this goes terribly wrong in other family businesses, which often happens in family business center environments. The other thing I've seen is the owner finds some sort of new purpose. I know one family business who the next generation had two members. One of them was very, very, very capable of running the business. The other one wasn't even terribly capable of holding a 40-hour a week job. he had so many issues. It wasn't a good fit, right? And part of it was a disability that he had. So what ended up happening is the third generation owner let the fourth generation owner run the business. And then he went and did this little spinoff with his other son that was absolutely at his capability level. Like he started selling stuff at flea markets on Saturdays.
Oh, cool.
Right? I mean, very small scale. I don't know. The last time we checked, I think they made $35,000 last year. But now this kid has a $35,000 income that he created for himself.
Cool.
Instead of being the annoying guy at the office, right? So that was hugely successful. But what happened is that third generation owner found a new entrepreneurial place to put his energy because he loved that part of business.
And do you see, like, I'm just, which makes sense, and it's like a great journey. Like, I'm assuming, because I think it, a lot of this also like has to be done in conjunction with the finances, because like I watch people stay in family businesses like that should do that, but they think the only way they get the estate plan is to stay in the business. So like, is there some clarity that's brought to them that says, hey, by the way, you're still going to get this percentage of the business, or that, you know, so-and-so is going to buy you out when they have the money, or like some sort of plan that frees them up to know that that's a possibility. Yeah.
So here's my little fantasy world I'm living in that I hope becomes a reality. I hope that the pandemic that we're all living through right now inspires people to get that, to get their estate plans, their wills, their buy-sell agreements, their bylaws, all updated, signed, and communicated.
Yeah, that's, I mean, it's more timely and relevant than anything right now.
Right? And I really believe when people do that, and when they do it with good advisors, and good advisors, I mean, people who connect what those documents say to what the legacy is they're trying to create, right? Instead of just saying, well, here's what I tell all my family businesses. You have two kids, give them each 50. No, that's bad advising. The question needs to be, what is the legacy? What are you trying to accomplish? Let's build all of your plans around that. When that gets updated, signed, and communicated, people have so much more freedom to make decisions.
I want to pull this because it's your SAGE mission, right? And I want to respectful of your time. If we got time to pull this thread, I'd be happy to. Because the fifth principle in the intentional growth principles is your team of advisors, and we refer to the outside team. So legal, estate, tax, wealth, real estate, insurance, like kind of the people that are out there advising you. What does good look like, and what happens if you don't find good?
Yeah. So to me, good looks like this. They do not take a one size fits all approach. They build your plan around what you're trying to do. I like to say to people, if you wanted to remodel your kitchen and somebody walked in and said, oh, well, here's the kitchen I always do, you'd kick them out, right? You don't want everybody else's kitchen. You don't want everybody else's plan. And then that's the second piece there is a great advisor is at the top of their game as far as their education, their continuing education, and their real life experience. They also have high expectations and will challenge you if you're about to make terrible, destructive decisions.
So challenge
to
you.
To me, that's what great advisors are. Yeah. They'll say, okay, you're going to give the business to your two kids. One of them is great to run it. The other one has a hard time coming into work every day for good reason. Should they both own it? Is that really the right choice for you? A great advisor is going to ask that question and show you the many ways you might do the family thing, which is called fair is equal, in a way that's also appropriate for people's skill sets, abilities, and interests, right? So they'll push you on that and have you really think that through, and then they will encourage transparency.
So I think those are good. Those are good attributes. I would also, another question would be is that, you know, the challenge that I had before spending the last 6 years doing this is, how do you, when you don't know enough about estate planning or wealth or tax planning or any of that stuff, vet out the people that are full of bullshit. And there's a lot of them out there who just want to just say yes and bill your time or sell a product that you didn't know was driving the motivation. And the second part of that question is, how do you figure that out, and how do you vet out the good ones, which I think you're going to have an answer to. But then also, I realize that there's a lot of advisors out there, especially with the big push towards this whole exit planning industry, that these advisors know absolutely nothing about your business. So like, they don't know what it's worth actually, or they are advising you when all the wealth is trapped in the business. The wealth manager is now giving you advice about how to run your business and ERP systems and, you know, accrual versus cash. And like, they're just not, they're way out of their lane. Not to say that some of them might have dual education on that, but there's this whole crossover of like the outside advisors that are dealing with your technical infrastructure. And then there's the business consultants. So that's kind of the second part of like making sure there's people are staying in their lanes, but maybe start with like, how do you determine who's the right fit?
Yeah. So I'll say one piece, and on thesagepages.com, it shares our philosophy, which is about eight pieces that you look for, and you can ask a person, right? Do you have a standard one-size-fits-all approach to this? If the answer is yes, that's all you need to know. Don't. Now, they might have a standard approach they would use with you that says, you know, we're going to start by gathering all of your information, and then we're going to talk about what you want to do. You know, that's good. That's their great process they're going to work you through. But if they have a standard answer for you, no matter what your industry is or what your legacy is or what you're trying to do, it's a bad idea. Run as quickly as you can. They're very disrespectful, in my opinion. So follow that philosophy of making sure they look at your business and your needs in the right way. And then the second piece is, and part of that, I should say, is, are they wanting to know your values and how you like to do stuff? That's really important. Sure. And then do they have experience?
Right.
Do they have actual experience doing this? Really worth the extra cash to have somebody who has the experience.
How do you, what have you seen that people do that's good? Where like, I go back to, again, it was 7-8 years ago, but I'm younger and I'm looking at all these people in suits. I'm like, well, you must be really smart. And then as I've been doing this, I'm like, I mean, one of the top CPA firms here in town didn't know what a 338H10 was. 338H10 totally could have saved us a couple million bucks. And we were their third acquisition ever, even though they got 200 CPAs. And so like you start to go, that sucks. So many on so many fronts where I think there's just like kind of what the EOS gets it once has got the capacity, getting the capacity and understanding like, have you done this? And what, how do you, like, if these owners haven't gotten the technical, you know, education that you or I or the people that are in this industry have, how do you vet out the people that are really good at listening and persuading you that they care, but don't have the technical backing?
So that is my deep, passionate plea to people is please take the slow down up front. To ask these questions. Have you done this before? What did it look like? Let me be honest with you. I've never done this before. I'm paying you because you have done it before. Ask around, see what the references are. Really dig in on that person. And then also, if you don't feel comfortable asking them those kinds of questions, that tells you something. Mm-hmm. That relationship is not going well. You have to be able to bare your soul to a lot of these advisors in order to get great advice.
And get them to collaborate.
No, by the way, don't bear your soul to your banker, but everybody else bear your soul, right?
I will totally second that statement.
Yeah, right.
Tell them you are fine and that you need to increase line of credit.
Right. We're doing great. Good to see you. How are the kids? See you later. But everybody, if you don't even feel comfortable to ask them and probe and say, how have you done this before? And what would this look like? And talk to me about what my experience will be working with you. If you don't even feel like you can ask that, that right there is a clue that it's the wrong person. And then what you do is you call your friends and your neighbors and you ask for references. You check out the Sage pages. You call a person that you do trust and ask them who they would recommend. It's not easy. I mean, same thing, right? Like, how do you find a great person to remodel your kitchen? Same idea, right?
If well, you I have can t- the I can nerve tell you to say to somebody, every way.
Right?
Every way is how not to do it. Oh my God, literally.
Yes.
Right now. Yep. Yep.
It's same idea, right? If you can't say to a contractor, I need you to walk me through this because you do kitchens every day and I do kitchens once every decade, right? If you don't feel comfortable saying that to them, they're probably not the right contractor. Mm-hmm. Same idea here.
And then,
in my opinion,
I agree. And I know we're running short of time, so I apologize. But maybe we could do a second version of this about the team of advisors.
Because, awesome.
Well, I just think there's a lot of advisors out there right now because there's this perceived industry of exit planning, but no one knows what it is, and it's how do you pay for it?
Yes.
A lot of these advisors have been moving into like, hey, I can help you with your business, and they shouldn't be. Or there's some people that can. The analogy I would give, Sarah, is that the only people that I've met thus far that are capable of like giving advice on operations in a business and the financial structures of things are private equity firms because they're using a business as an investment tool, right? And again, I would even argue that a lot of them haven't run their own businesses, so it's still a challenge. But like, you know what I'm saying? Yep. There's this whole like. Oh, you know, I've had attorneys give business advice or wealth managers or, you know, CPAs. And it's like, well, have you ever fired your VP of sales? And how does that work? And how do you do it? Like, it's just a whole different animal of like the operational strategies you should be applying. I mean, are you seeing lots of cross-pollination there? Or am I kind of making this up in my head?
No, I don't think you're making it up. And I agree, this really worries me because there is this perception of this multi-billion dollar opportunity of helping businesses transition. I think a lot of people jumping into the pool, not with their eyes completely wide open. And one of my strong beliefs is advisors should be willing, one, should be willing to get fired. They should not be yes men or mm-hmm. women. Mm-hmm. And number two, they must be willing to bring in somebody to help in the ways they're not good. They just have to. And if they're not willing to do that, they're a bad idea. You know, why? I certainly should not be giving financial advice to any of my clients ever. As an EOS implementer, I am really good at helping them figure out numbers that should go on a scorecard. But what lever to pull financially, that is not my, that is not what they pay me for. And I should not make comments about that. I'm not a HR expert. Mm-hmm. I'm not a marketing expert, but I can do a hell of a job helping them get a really clear marketing strategy. Great at that. But execution, if I think I should be doing that, I need to be fired. So that's a
or
big
bring
concern.
Someone in.
We share
right?
a big concern. Absolutely. I think I can do it, bad idea. I know great people who can come in and do a much better job for less money than me. I should do that.
And I think that's what, and we'll wrap up because I know you got to run, is, it's connecting dots for and resources to accelerate people's path to the right resources to get them to their goal. And there's a lot of noise out there, and it's extremely, there's a lot of good reasons to shell up inside of your turtle shell. And if you're the owner, when it's just like, you know what, I'm just not going to deal with this. So give us the, how do you find the advices? What's your recommendation between, if you're an owner, how do you go connect dots to you? Where do we find you? What's your big takeaway?
Oh, sure. Yeah. Come find me at the Sage Pages. It's like the Yellow Pages, but a wiser way to find an advisor. The philosophy is there. You can get a hold of me there. That's probably the easiest way. You can find the Sage Pages on LinkedIn or Sarah B. Stern on LinkedIn. I'm happy to help people figure this out. I'm passionate about it. I want them to have respectful and competent help. And I'll do anything I can to help that happen. My vision for the Sage Pages is that this is a worldwide resource for family businesses. And it's starting now, and it's starting in the Midwest. And, you know, come get help early on and be part of it as it grows.
Can I ask you one clarifying question about it before we let you go?
Yeah.
How are you vetting out the resources that you're putting on there?
Yeah, good question. Well, I have my clear philosophy. Every advisor needs to apply, and that application dives into the philosophy. I do an interview, and I've already been told, Sarah, if you want to go worldwide, that's not scalable. But we're going to have to figure that out, because I think it's important to look in people's eyes and talk through what does it look like to be a part of this. And then I'm doing lots of education for the family businesses that come through, so that they're also helping me find great people who fit with the philosophy.
That's awesome. Well, this has been a lot of fun. I appreciate you taking time out of your virtual day to come me in the podcast.
It's been really fun, Ryan. Thanks for the opportunity to help your audience.